Something for panelists or something like that. That's why I asked you.
Oh, sir, it's fine, sir. Nothing, nothing, sir.
Everybody is on the same link only, yeah.
Nothing, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. On research methodology. This session will deal with specific procedures and techniques which are used to identify, select, and analyze information about a given scientific topic. This contains two components. One is data collection, the second component is data analysis. And here we have Dr. Alban Zigamani, who is the group head of clinical research in the Narayana Health all over the nation. So we are lucky to have him. He has extensive experience in research. In fact, he has published over 75 papers in both national and international journals.
Murli sir, kindly unmute Murli sir.
Unmute me like that, no, please. So, we are extremely lucky to have Dr. Alban Zigamani, who is the group head for clinical research in the NH family. That is, we have 32 hospitals in India and a couple of hospitals outside India. He heads all the research in all these areas. And with this vast experience and experience not only in research methods but also in publications, I think he is the best person to deal with this topic. And I would, without wasting much time, I'll request Dr. Alban Zigamani to take over and give a talk on research methodology, which is of vital importance to not only DNP students but also to the faculty members to know how to do research, how to guide students, and for the students how to do research so that they can start their process of thesis topic identification, protocol writing, protocol, and knowing the methodology, how to do the statistics, etc., all the paraphernalia which is needed to do a research study. I think Dr. Alban Zigamani will make it an encapsulated talk so that we will be benefited. And please pay attention to each word it is being said, which will help us to identify and understand the topic much better. With this, I will request Dr. Alban Zigamani to take over and carry on with the proceedings. Dr. Alban Zigamani, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. And thank you, Dr. Muralidhar Kanji, for that kind introduction. And thank you, Dr. Srinath and Anbai, to have made this arrangement for this call, for this session. And yeah, this is a topic which is very dear to me. This is what I do. I do 24/7. So I like to share some experiences of mine in the process of trying to teach you some basics in the research methodology. And all of you will agree that, you know, the whole topic about research methodology actually calls for an entire workshop, of which we used to do in, when I used to be in St. John's, we used to do it over a 2-week period. And we used to do it as a compulsory residential course. That means to say, people coming for that course can't even go back to their own families also. We used to make it that compulsory to make them and stay, because there's a lot of things that you need to understand before you can learn to do this. So like some skills in life come by just by putting an effort. Like, you know, you learn to ride your first bicycle by first getting onto the cycle and taking that little leap of faith of learning to ride the bicycle, and the reason, but there is a purpose behind it. You know, sometimes we forget about the purpose of why we try to do, and I'm sure many of you would agree that one of the purpose at that point in time is to be mobile, and you know, to be able to go to your friend's place, or you know, go to the shop and buy something and come. You feel good that you have something of your own, and somebody buys you the cycle and gives it to you on your birthday, and then you learn to ride it, and then you do it. Sometimes we do things in life without really understanding why we do it, and that's when things become a little boring for us. And sadly to say that many DNB students, I've noticed that my experience when they come to me, and forget about DNB, I'm talking about anybody in doing post-graduation, they come to me with a very sad, long face, saying that, sir, I have to do my thesis. And the reason they feel that is because they don't feel connected to that particular activity of doing a thesis. And that is one of the reasons why people don't really take an effort of writing or doing a particular activity, which is actually, if you learn to do certain aspects of it, you'll realize it is actually fun doing it. And it is actually bringing a lot of joy for yourself. And that's something which you should try to. I hope I'm audible.
Yes, you are very much audible and very clear.
Thank you so much. Okay, so going straight into the topic, I think we should start by understanding this definition of research. And if you're according to the Oxford English Dictionary, they say research is a careful search. It's an endeavor to discover new facts or collate old facts by critical study. So basically, in a very simple way, if you put it, research is about searching for an answer to a question. So when you say thesis is just a process. But basically what you're doing there is research. And in that, your journey starts as a clinician. You know, you've just come out as an MBBS doctor, you've done some level of basic post-graduation training. And now you're trying to get yourself into a clinician where you're going to start treating patients, you're going to be making choices of therapy, you're going to be dealing with decisions with regards to life and death matter. You know, there are going to be a lot of challenges that will come in front of you where you will have to know what to do, and you need to learn what is the right thing to do. Now, if you ask me, where did that information all come from? Nothing came on its own. You know, everybody has gone through this process of asking a research question. Somebody is taking the trouble of answering it, and then it becomes common practice, which sometimes you do in your clinic. Be it looking at the blood pressure of a person, be it taking the height of a patient, or you know, the whole process of intubating a person. All of these things has happened through trial and error, and it has happened when people realized there was a need and there was something, there was a gap that was identified. So everything in life, for that matter, actually starts with a research question, and we try to institutionalize this by putting down certain processes. So that's what this whole aspect of methodology is all about, is you trying to institutionalize. You basically, what you're trying to do is to create new knowledge, which is needed to improve healthcare. And most importantly, if this knowledge is not available, you'll probably be doing harm to the patient. You may be doing something wasteful and expensive. And you may be also doing something which is not logical at all. And the reason behind it is because somebody has not sat down and taken the trouble to understand what is the right thing to do. So research is a process, which is a process which you have to continue to do, and the reason why the is asking students, or if any for that matter, any postgraduate is asked to do a thesis, is for them to start learning this process and try to understand that this is how you gain new knowledge. This is how you are able to contribute to improving healthcare. So like I was telling in the beginning, unless you see the purpose of this thesis, you would probably look at it as some activity which you just need to tick off on a checklist. So that is one of the reasons why people find it difficult. They find it tough. They say it is boring. They find it, you know, I'm not getting sufficient support. Nobody is helping me out. So you feel all these kind of frustrations because you suddenly feel that you're doing this for somebody else. So if you can internalize this and say that this is being done for my own good, I'm going to learn something out of it. I'm sure the half the journey is completed, and the, you know, you will start enjoying what you're trying to do. Now, research is also a path to find the truth. Now, you want to know what is the truth behind that particular problem. You know, how do we actually arrive at that answer? Now, as you know, truth is not very easy to find in any matter of life. You know, it is something which is very hard to find unless you have everything in black and white and everything is placed in front of you as this is A and this is B. It is difficult to recognize what is right, what is wrong. It is difficult to recognize what is beneficial, what is harmful. It's always you are trying to find the mid path, or you're trying to find the truth. You're trying to find what is most right for you and that patient, or you in that hospital, or you in that department, wherever you are. So what is the first thing that you generally try to do when you walk into any institution or you come to a very unfamiliar place? Let's say, for example, you walk into a food court of a mall without knowing how to order your food. What will you do? You will just stand there and observe for some time, and you'll see what is the process. And then you may ask some people, and then you go about doing that particular action which everybody else is doing. So similarly, in research also, there is this process which starts with this whole thing about what should I do. And unless you kind of get knowledge and some guidance in that past perspective, you're not going to be able to move forward. And the guide is that person who gives you that kind of a path to action. It tells you what he or she will tell you what you should do. Now, there is the national board which tells you what you should do. In our hospital in Narayana, we have the research committee, we have the research department. So there are a lot of people who tell you what to do. Now, why I'm saying this is, you should not at any given point in time and come and tell that I did not do it because I did not know what to do. And we had a recent experience with some students coming and telling that they did not know what to do when another 2 weeks they are going to be, I think tomorrow or day after tomorrow, they need to be submitting their thesis, the full thesis. So you have to take that responsibility of on your own, right? You need to take the responsibility of finding out what you should do. So in research also, the same thing happens. And you need somebody to guide you. That's why you have a guide. And then you have other people also to guide you, to tell you what you should do. Then the next part of it is, once you know what you should do, you should learn what is going to come out of it. Now, this is a very important component, because unless you realize that there is something that you're going to gain, there's some knowledge that you're going to gain, you will not connect yourself to that particular activity. You'll think that I'm doing this for somebody else. You'll think that you are doing it for the sake of my guide. The very common kind of a thing is that my guide told me to do this. So you the guide is already telling you what you can do, but it's you need to make that effort to understand whether this is the thing that I want to learn. Is it something which I can get? So it could be something that the guide also is trying to learn along with you. But there is always some new knowledge creation that is happening, and you are contributing to that part of it. You need to kind of connect to that part. And the last part of it is, it should also transform you. The research that you do should transform in the way what you believe is that particular action. It can be as simple as, maybe it will transform the way I will see the next patient coming in with cardiac arrest. It could be the way it will transform me, the way I believe I should treat the patient who's coming with a urinary stone. You know, there has to be something that will change in you, which is needed at a very early stage for you to understand what you're doing. Now, if you do not keep these three paths in your mind and you go about doing research, you will have no direction to go. So I think each student who was participating in this workshop today, and in future also, as you go along, keep this in mind that your guide is somebody who's telling you what you should do, but you should also have a reason why you're trying to do that. Now, this is important because only then you will understand the next few aspects which I'm going to try. So today's talk, I'll try to cover the topic in these kind of four or five different points. I am not going to go into statistics, which is a very detailed subject. The scope of today cannot go deep into that, but I will touch upon certain aspects about statistics, which are important, and why that importance can generate itself, it will ease itself into that by understanding certain processes. Okay, so to start with, like I said, every research starts with the question. Now, it's an idea or a concept that is derived from some preliminary data. So many of us call it the parent article. Somebody come and tell, I got this article, sir. I like this article. What is done in that article? I'd like to do this. Now, yes. But if you are only somebody who is going to repeat what somebody else did, you're not going to address the second and third component, what I told. You will have a direction of what you can do, but you're not going to gain any new knowledge, because whatever that article has told, you can read it. You just have to spend half an hour reading that article and maybe discussing another half an hour with a friend or a colleague, and you've got that knowledge. Why go through an entire 2-year period just to repeat that? Okay. So you need to be able to ask yourself, what is it that is making me A, interested in that particular article, and what should I be doing? And how can I answer something different? So this is where I find that sometimes there's a disconnect. I found a very good article. I want to do this. So you stop there. You don't think further than that. You just want to replicate whatever that person did, and you just want to come and make it as a protocol of yours. You do not accept the second and third part of it, which is a path of knowledge creation and a path of devotion. Will it change you? Will it kind of make you change your entire belief? Once you've got a topic, the next thing about it is to plan it. Now, this is a very important phase. You need to sit down and think, I have 6 months now, I have 1 year's time, I have 2 years' time, or I have 5 years' time. If you're a super specialist person, you need to plan it. That's why DNB asks you also within the first 90 days to choose your topic, choose your guide, choose your topic, and submit your protocol. Because then you will get the entire remaining months for you to complete your project, design and complete your project. Don't start planning the last 3 months or 6 months of your course. I've done all these other, I've not done my thesis, let me do something about it. And You need to plan it to understand what is your hypothesis, what are the way, what are the data that we're going to collect, how are you going to design the study. Like I said, don't just copy that old design and replicate it. Can I use the same design or not? All these things need to be thought through. Then comes this thing about sample size. People think that sample size, and I'll kind of touch upon sample size a little later, but sample size actually is derived from this entire activity. You would get some guidance from that parent article that you read, but at the same time, it also comes from the guide. Hello? Okay. So then it'll help you to define what is your sample size. You need to plan it. You need to be able to probably, you may want to do a little bit of pilot data collection. You may want to go and observe in the ward for some time and see, will I get these kind of cases? You need time for that. So you need to do planning. And then you have the whole process of collecting the data, putting the data, putting the protocol together, going to the ethics committee, getting permission, and then you implement the project. So the implementation starts from the time that you've written the protocol, ethics committee approval, scientific review committee approval, ethics committee approval, and it goes all the way to completing the study. And then it comes to analysis. See, if you see, now I always see people coming and telling, oh, thesis means analysis. No, thesis doesn't mean analysis. Thesis always, they always, oh, my biggest burden is I don't know what, I don't have a statistician. No, the statistician's role, if you see here, is a very small role. Out of the five activities, only one activity is the statistician's role. Four activities are yours. It is your job to be able to conceive the idea, plan it, have an entire activity of implementing it, and it comes down. Now, the statistician can help you in the planning. Now, if you talk to a statistician, if you have a good statistician, you can go and talk to the statistician. Statistician will help you to plan it. A statistician could also help you understand the data. Yes, there is a role for these people to play here, but it is something which is driven by you. You can't have a statistics department, a research department chasing you to do thesis. You know, sometimes we get that kind of a feeling that, you know, you are doing the thesis for the sake of the research department, and the research department has to chase you all to get the thesis done. No, it is your job. It is your responsibility to do it, and you need to enjoy doing it. And that's why we are here to help. So this is the process. Now, what are the types of clinical questions? We generally ask these questions basis of frequency. What is the number of times a particular event happens? Or what is the percentage of people having a particular risk factor? So very commonly used aspect by all DNB students is to just measure frequencies. And I've seen people writing pages and pages of, you know, pie charts on frequencies and other things. It is good, but, you know, don't make your study entirely on frequency. Go a little bit into etiology and understanding causality. Now, this is where hypothesis generation happens. You know, you find something that you're uncomfortable with, or you find something that the patients are uncomfortable with, and you try to find out the reason why that is happening. So most studies that I've noticed, people come to me with designs and they say, no, I just want to describe this population. I want to observe this population. Yes, you're observing something, but you don't stop at just capturing frequencies. Go a little deeper into etiology and causality. Now, there it can be either it could be diagnostics, it could be effectiveness of some treatments, or it could be just the clinical course and prognosis, you know. Can I prognosticate based off some aspect that I see? So if you see, clinical questions is something which is generated by these broad five categories. Now, sixth category, some people are interested. Can I make it more cost efficient? You know, I do see some thesis topics. We would like to see whether, you know, this type of surgery is more cost efficient than that. It is an important aspect, but sometimes a little difficult to be done at a DNB level. So we generally do not expect people to do efficiency or cost efficiency or economic evaluations in their thesis. So most theses would cover frequency, etiology,
And it could be either of a diagnostic test or an effectiveness of an intervention, or it could be a course, clinical course and prognosis. So if you see, this encompasses all your topics that you generally choose from, and you could look for this kind of information in the department that you're working. Now, whenever some student comes to me and they say, sir, I want to study this, they'll tell, that's all they'll tell. I want to study the effect of treatment A on patients. I step back and I tell them, give me a research question. And at that time, the person is a little, you know, most students, you know, no, sir, I want to study this. You know, see, what you want to study is a process. It's a methodology, or what is that? You know, it is what we talked about here, you know, frequency, etiology, diagnostic test, whatever it is. That is what, that is not your research question. Your research question is something which is going to, you know, help you write a protocol. You know, it will help you stay focused on, you know, what you're trying to do. If you don't have, then you tell, no, I'll collect this and I'll answer everything under it. You know, then you're not going to be focused. I look at all the frequency. I look at all the etiology. I look at all the diagnostic tests. I will look at anything that is prognosticated. And I'll, you know, wherever I find a p-value which is significant, I'll show it in a nice red color. No, that is not how research is to be done. You know, these are clinical questions. These are the different types of discussion questions. But you need to know what is that question. Now, I will dwell a little deep, go into why you have, how you ask a research question and why it is important. Now, we're always faced with this challenge. Now, when I say, okay, give me a research question, then people really kind of, what is my research question? What, how do I frame it? You know, I can answer the question that I'm studying. I'm looking at, you know, effect of hypertension on patients undergoing surgery A, or age-related comorbidities or something. So, but, you know, how do I frame this question is always a, you know, dilemma in many people. So the first thing about research question is to take a topic of interest. You know, you need to connect yourself to that topic. Now, generally, this topic of interest comes from your guide. And most of the times it is already predefined and you are just a participatory role there. It's okay because you are still a student, you're still learning. So in that situation, it's still okay to be accepting a topic of interest that's coming from your guide. Now, because then you will get more help, you'll get more support because the guide is also interested in that topic. So you can develop a research question basis of a topic of interest. If that is not there, you could then go start searching literature. You could say, oh, I'm in surgery department. I am in pediatrics. I am in neurology. I am in, you know, general medicine or pulmonology. What's most interesting in the literature out there? You know, is there something that is recently published in JAMA or Lancet? Is there something that we can do or similar to that kind of a thing? Yes, those are all starting points, but like I was telling, you know, hello? Somebody needs to mute their mic.
Yeah, it's done, sir. Please go ahead, sir.
Yeah. If you have a question, please put up your hand and I will be happy to answer. Stop me anytime I can answer. Okay. Yeah, so you have to, you look at research question basis of literature. You read a literature and think. The next source for developing a research question, sometimes the guide is also new and, you know, he says that all my topics I had in my mind are already being done. Nothing seems to be interesting in the literature. Then it's good to go to a mentor. Now, who is a mentor? Mentor is somebody who believes and that you need to learn something. You know, he believes in your situation and he's trying to help you out. So find that person. It could be a friend, it could be a senior, it could be a person from another department. It could be somebody, you know, who has some experience in doing some activities and, you know, has published, you can go and ask them, sir, I'm not finding a topic of my interest to me. Can you help me? So, you know, you can go to a mentor and the mentor will help you getting a topic. So, but what is core for all of this is that you need to be committed and show some enthusiasm. Now, unless and until you are able to drive all of this, whatever you're doing, just with the, without commitment and enthusiasm, nothing is going to happen. It'd be like, you know, slogging a dead horse. You know, we're trying to, the guide will be chasing you with a topic. They will ask you to go search for literature. And then there will be nobody who wants to mentor you because, you know, you've gone to that person once or twice. And then after that, that person, you have never even bothered to respond to his phone calls or go and meet him. Then everything is just going to fall apart. So most important in all of this is developing a research question is having a commitment and an enthusiasm in doing so. Now, where do we find these research questions? Okay. So I already said it could be coming from previous research, which is very commonly used practice by all DNB students. And like I said, there's nothing wrong in that, but try to frame your own research question from it. It could be a completely new idea or a technology which you have found something very interesting. Little cautious there. Because you have time limits, you have resource limits. So don't get yourself into something which is going to be very difficult for you to do. But if you can, go ahead. You know, if you are somebody who likes to take a challenge like that, go ahead. Many people start by, which is a good practice to do, is to start by doing a little bit of clinical observation. Now, you've just joined the department. You're probably just finding your way through. You're just getting to see some patients in the ward or maybe in the hospital, in the OPD. Carry a small little notebook with you or even in your phone, take some pictures or whatever it is. Maintain a small little log for yourself and make some clinical observations and say, I'm noticing many of the patients in my department are having this kind of a problem. It helps you to start a discussion about a research question. Okay. Attend teaching sessions like these, or, you know, there are plenty of it available on the net right now. That's one big advantage with COVID that I've seen with regards to research and academics. A lot of people putting up their material free of cost available right now. So you can actually go there and attend a few webinars, and that will help you get you some ideas of how to get your research question. And like I said, everything in clinical medicine starts off with a variation, and you look at a variation in the particular topic and then you start off. So you start your research. So it could just be like if this is included in the aspect of clinical observation, where, you know, you just see some group of patients doing differently, or they are being, they respond differently to your treatment, or they don't seem to be doing well. So that variability also can become a curiosity for yourself to be able to, help you write a research question. Now, what are the elements of a research question? Now you have a topic, you have a guide, you have some kind of a topic, you've got a thing. Now is the, what are the elements that you should not miss out when you start writing a research question? Before we get into that, this is another time check with regards to, if I take a particular research question, suddenly you might suddenly find something, lot of things interesting. Okay. Oh, I've read some article. Oh, I found this interesting. I found that interesting. I saw all these kind of patients in my department has got a lot of data, a lot of patients. Then you have a problem of choice. Okay. So don't try to do a lot of research questions within that time period that you have. I know, sir, I'll answer all these things. You'll have 10 different research questions. That's not going to help. It's not going to help you. It's not going to help the DNB board to understand what you're trying to do. And definitely your research is not going to be successful. So you have limitations of resources, time, And so you answer whatever is important. And the relative importance of a question can change depending on the perspective of whoever poses it. So, like I said, you might find an article which is very interesting and say, I want to do it. But the way the doctor has, that particular author has posed the question, maybe you can ask the question slightly differently. Maybe on retrospect, when you read that article, maybe the doctor should have asked this question like this. Why don't we do a research like this and see? So it is important. And sometimes it'd be, oh, the study was probably done 8 years ago, 10 years ago. Now a lot of things has changed. The way we define the problem has changed. The way we manage or triage these patients are different. So that will also give you a new, you can just replicate the same thing. So see, there's no harm in replicating a particular study. But if you have asked the question, you know, is there a relative importance of that question in this time era? Then you've actually added something new there, and that becomes a new research question for yourself. So selection of the question can happen in these different possible ways. Very important to think a little innovative, you know, otherwise it becomes boring. You know, you if you don't find something which is going to make it look attractive for you or anybody, you know, it becomes boring. So when I say innovate, you don't have to discover something new, but try to do something different from what that other people have done. And if you think a little bit and you ask your guide, you ask your mentor, you will get that you'll get an answer to that. But very important, it has to be approachable, and you need to maintain that, you know, you are only doing a DNP student, you have limitations of time, and you have limitations because you need to do your clinical duties, you have your clinical rotations, and in between all of this, you want to do this. So it has to meet certain requirements from a scientific perspective. When I say adequate sample size here, it doesn't mean that you need to know a sample size. Even a sample size of 10 sometimes is good enough. Okay. So that's why I say adequate, so that you have sufficient to get some answer from that particular question. So the problem that we sometimes lose track of when we go and ask a sample size is that particular research question appealing to me. We forget to lose that. If you know that part of it, then sample size can be always explained. Okay, you can explain it on the basis of your time limit, you explain the basis of your feasibility. And this is again brings in the whole concept about whether you do a retrospective study or a prospective study. And some people call this, you know, retrospective and prospective study. So all of this would come in from that perspective. And if you've thought through these processes, then you will be able to decide for yourself, can I do this in the 2 years that I have, or should I go back in time and collect data? So then, you know, your research question also needs to be modified according to that. So all of this requires planning, and that's why it's good to start with a research question. So if you write down a proper research question, you'll be able to answer this. And obviously it has to be interesting, and it needs to be relevant. You know, don't tell something which everybody is already, you know, written off. You know, don't try to do a thesis topic on a topic which everybody has said, no, this is not going to work. Nobody is doing it. Nobody, even if you do something, nobody is going to be interested, because everybody has either, you know, accepted it as a common practice, or everybody has already written it off and saying this is not important. Most important in all of this is ethics. And I'll probably delve a little bit into ethics a little later. But what I'm trying to say here is that relevance can be on the basis of scientific knowledge. It could be on the basis of clinical care and health policy, in the sense, am I trying to make a difference in the way these patients can be treated? And also it could be something like a hypothesis generating kind of a research. People have not written anything about it so far. I am going to be doing something so that tomorrow people can ask more questions. So it could be so relevance can be measured by various ways. It need not be just saying something which is really attractive, and you know, first time people has asked this kind of a question, very rarely you will be able to think that way. Nowadays, with the information at your fingertips, you go and tell something, this is the first time we are doing the study, somebody sitting in the scientific review will just quickly do a Google search and tell, no, the study has been done here, in NHLE we have done it. You will be stuck. So, you know, relevance is very important, and look at it from the perspective of whether it is, like I said, you know, put those three points there. Is it possible for you to do it? Is it of some interest to you? Can I connect myself to it? And is there somebody to help me in doing that? So I'll kind of take a stop here and maybe ask if there are any questions with anybody so far in understanding why it is important to have a research question. And in that context, does anybody have a question on where can I find the research question, or what should I do if I don't have a research question? Those kind of doubts, is anybody having? I can answer those things now. Anyone?
There is no question in the chat box as well.
Okay, sir.
So we'll see at the end if there are any questions, we'll try to address it that time.
Okay, sir, we'll continue. Now, I'll touch upon ethics a little later, but all of you should remember that, you know, ethics is something which is something which appeals to you as a human being. And if that appeals to you as a human being, then you will know what is the importance of ethics. But certain nuances of it, maybe we can cover it in a different forum. But, you know, any research should not be unethical. So that's the bottom line of the research question. You can't do a research question just for the sake of answering a question. If there's an ethical issue around it, it's not going to go forward. Okay, so moving down. So this is what, you know, we use this guideline for a research question called the finer criteria. And this is what I was kind of explaining so far to you. So it is a very easy scale to apply. So if your guide has given you a topic, or you've read an article, you've found something interesting, or you feel that you want to do something, or a friend has told you to do something, apply the final criteria. Is it feasible for me to do? Will I find people who are interested in it alongside with me? Is it having some kind of an innovation? Is it something which people have not done in the past? Does it have something novel to talk about? If it's already published, and like I said, you know, don't take a parrot article and just repeat the same thing and keep, you know, have something new to be talked about from that. It has to be ethical and it has to be relevant. So if you apply these five criteria, you will not be making any gross errors in your research question. So the first step for any thesis is to get yourself a good research question, and this needs effort. You know, you need to do a bit of reading, you need to ask a few people, and then go about doing it. Then the technicality of the research question is like, okay, now I have a research question in my mind. Now comes the methodology part of it. Okay, now this is a little technical. Now, when I say a research question, it should have these five components. Okay, if I do not keep these five components in my research question, my research question will be incomplete and it will not help you to move forward. So the first one, most important one, is the population. Whom am I going to study this research into? So the population or the characteristics of that subjects. What kind of characteristics? So there again, you need to see whether it is connected to your specialization. You may be doing a topic in pulmonary medicine, but your entire, whatever you want to learn in entire research is going to come from the radiology department, from CT scans.
Now, I'm not telling you not to do it with CT scans, but you should be able to define that it is a population of people where pulmonology is involved and CT scan is an enabler. Now, the same topic can be taken up by a radiologist and said, it is for me, it is the scans which are being done in all these group of people. So you see how the population would change according to your specialization. So, you know, I've seen sometimes topic coming and saying, I'd like to do a study on CT scan. Then the person is actually doing MD, doing a DNB in medicine. Now, the DNB board will not be able to understand why is an DNB medicine student doing topic in relation to, it could be sometime in pathology. It could be something in microbiology. Now you need to be able to define that population. You need to be, if you don't define it correctly, they will be doing a wrong topic. Second part of it is the intervention or the exposure. You know, we just use the word I here, but it is like, you know, what is that is of interest to you in that particular population? Now, this is where the difference will happen. I was telling, you know, from a radiologist looking at it, from a thing. So you are looking, you need to understand, is there something that the patient has been exposed to? Like say, for example, now people are studying about CT scan changes in COVID-19. Now, if a radiologist is asking that question, he will want to just describe the CT findings in different stages of COVID-19. And he'll tell that I found these changes and these changes were you know, relevant when it comes to making a diagnosis of severe ARDS versus mild to moderate severe. Now, the same question can be asked by the medicine people. Now, is the load of the virus being reflected on a CT scan? You know, is the patient's exposure of viruses or his comorbid illnesses reflecting severity basis of a CT scan? So you're using the CT scan as the same topic, but the way you have put it across will change according to your subject. Then obviously, whenever you're doing some, you're looking at a particular exposure, you need to control it with something which is not exposed. Now here, you always, I see a big challenge among students. No, sir, I'm doing a one group study. Now, yes, you are doing a study, but when you are analyzing it, you will be analyzing it, comparing it with somebody. So there are ways to pick up even in a single group to do comparator studies. So you can look at one exposure group or an outcome group and you can compare it. So there will always be something to compare. If there is nothing to compare. If there is nothing to compare, then you're basically doing a descriptive study. Okay? So always remember that you will have something to compare, because otherwise you will not be able to tell whether something is more or less than something else. So always there will be a control. Now you're not going to be taking a control as a separate group. It will be something which you will arrive at through your analysis in most the, you know, single group kind of studies that you're doing. But if you have the you know, time and resources, you can actually do a two group randomized control trial, then that's a different matter. The next thing in any research question, which is very important and many times people kind of tend to forget about it, is an outcome which is measured in the interest. Now I'll say I will look at all outcomes of patients who have COVID-19 and I will describe it. Now that is okay, but there has to be one outcome which is of main interest to you, why it's making you do the study. I probably want to know whether the severity of the illness is related with the mortality rate of the patient. So then the moment you say I want to look at mortality rate, that means you're looking at a group of people who died and a group of people who survived. So suddenly you see how a research question, by the time you reach your outcome itself, you've got your control. So sometimes you start with the population, you start with the exposure, you will not know what to take as a comparator. But if you look at the outcome, then from the outcome, you can see what is going to be your comparator. So this is how you have to have all these components in a research question. You know, there's always sometimes an argument when I say, you know, can you put your research question in these five components? No, so there is no comparator. The immediate answer comes, there is no comparator. As a single group study, sir. It's a one group study. You know, the point here is that, you know, you can't do any comparisons without with. Right? So you need something to compare it with. So this comparator, if you don't, if it's not defined to you when you're framing your research question, the moment you answer the question about what is the outcome that I want to look at, and this is why we sometimes tell, have one outcome of interest. And sometimes when a student comes to me, they tell me, sir, I want to study this. I'll tell, choose your outcome in this. No, sir, my guide wants to study all the outcomes. No, I said, no, fine. You can study all your outcomes, but you choose one thing which is important to you. And the reason is only with that you can understand what you're going to compare with. And little later I'll tell you that unless you know what you're comparing it with, you will not be able to calculate a sample size. Okay? So you see how it is getting connected with the research question itself. You're solving the problem of your analysis, of the biggest problem that you face, the sample size analysis, which is already getting solved by just points now. And the P part of it is a target, which is sometimes not necessary, but it can also be considered as time. T can be also looked upon as time, whether you're looking at it as a superiority study, if it's a double blind or it's a randomized controlled trial. It could be a time when it comes to observation studies. At time point A, patients with COVID-19, contract score 5, death mortality in 2 weeks time. So time comes into the picture. So T can be also time, which is important because an outcome in a patient can happen within 30 days. Your thesis. So you need to be able to tell in what time period I'm going to study this. Am I going to be studying in the last 5 years and in the next 3 years? Whatever time period, or it can be I want to look at outcomes of patients. So I want.
I'm there.
Sir?
Please go ahead, sir.
So you want to look at an outcome at discharge, or is it an outcome just immediate post-op? You know, you need to have that time period to be able to capture that event. If you just tell early outcomes, what is early? Doesn't mean anything. So that's why in a research question, we guide this. So it's a very good, easy, simple guide to use. If you have a research question, you put the final criteria, and then to write your research question, you put the PCOT criteria. Okay, so these are two important things as far as research question is concerned. Now a quick time check, sir. How much more time do I have?
You can take another 7 more minutes. It's all problem.
10 minutes. About 10 minutes you can take. Can okay. I say that? 10 minutes.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay, so I think we need to cover one more topic about writing the thesis. So I'll probably stop with the research question out here. So another way of framing a research question is to identify your predictor, outcome, and population. So like I said in the beginning, it could be basis of the final criteria is to see whether it is possible to do a PCOR criteria to define what are the population. And then to write the research question, you can put these three components, which will help you to write a research question in this manner. You know, it will ask you, does the predictor cause the outcome among the study population? So it helps you to write down the research question in the form of a research question. Now, because of time, I'll probably stop with regards to research question here. And if anybody has any questions, they can ask me right now while I move forward to understanding the whole aspect of writing your thesis.
There is one question which is in the chat box if you want to take it up. Yes, the question says, how will I know if the topic has not already been taken by somebody? And do we find all the material online? This is the question. So if you want to address it now, you can do that.
Yes.
The question is, how to know if the topic hasn't been done already?
Okay. So I hope the person who was asked this question has some familiarity with the internet. And the internet is your best source. You could start with the Google search. And a very important resource that you can use is to use something called PubMed. And I'll maybe quickly take you, if you're seeing my screen, can actually do this with regards to for searching of a research question. You could go to PubMed, and in PubMed you have something called clinical queries.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So in PubMed, if you go to clinical queries, you ask anything you want, you can ask them here. So your topic of interest. Now, how to put that topic of interest, that question there, you can use that ICHOR criteria. You can look at the topic or an article or whatever in your mind. You write that here. You say, like perioperative pain post cardiac surgery. So you'll get that. Now you see advanced here, that will help you to put basic question. Now I can look at cardiac event and I can build a search term. This is called building a search term. So there are ways to do it, and there is enough and more guidance that comes from PubMed itself in the form of YouTube videos, which you can use to answer that question. That's point number one. Point number two is ask your guide. Your guide will definitely be able to tell you whether this topic has already been done in the department or not. And that's in right. case you don't have it, then you can use, definitely internet is always there as your resource.
There is one more query about prevalence study. Is it advisable? How to calculate the study population for prevalence study? Albin, may I make one suggestion, if you don't mind? Srinath is also there?
Yes.
The suggestion is regarding the thesis.
Yes, sir.
Can we have one independent session, because that needs a sort of detailed discussion? Because
yes,
most of the students would like to listen to how to go about the thesis, because most of the students, when they come, they are confused and they have problems in dealing with the thesis. So my suggestion is to, because we are also running out of time, we have 2-3 minutes more.
Can I go into that? I'm going into that right now.
Yeah, yeah. So this prevalence study, is it advisable? I think we should have the thesis discussion in another session.
Yeah.
Srinath,
yeah,
don't you think so?
Yes, sir. I agree.
Because
sir,
we have two more minutes to go. And there are some other sessions scheduled from 4:30 onwards for family medicine and other areas. So,
okay. So I think, yeah, I'll just answer that question very simply, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now, when you say prevalence study, so prevalence is one measure of your thesis.
Yes.
Okay. It's like asking what is the frequency of something. So prevalence is just one measure. Now, yeah, you need to decide whether you're doing a descriptive study or an evaluative study.
Yes.
Now, prevalence, it is an evaluative study. You're trying to measure something. Now, where will that prevalence come from? You can get it from cross-sectional studies, or you can get it from cohort studies or case control studies. So observational studies give you prevalence. Now, the sample size calculation basis is coming from, again, the point that I was telling. You know, You need to understand what is your population, your intervention, your outcome, because you don't have a control. Your control will naturally come out when your analysis is happening. So it is derived from the research question. So this is the methodology of designs, whether you want to do a descriptive study or an evaluative study. Now, DNB expects everybody to do an evaluative study, which can be observational or experimental. Experimental, they are not expecting you, but definitely they are expecting you to do observational studies, evaluative. Do not stop at doing just, basically I see people collecting a bunch of data and it is basically a time series or a case series. That is not thesis.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
That's like a point I wanted to tell before we close.
Thank you, Alban, for that clarification. Is there any other question? I don't see anything on the chat box. And it's my pleasant duty to thank Dr. Alban for having taken us through this research methodology. Very well done. A lot of important points were discussed, especially with regard to conception, planning, implementation, analysis, and communication. And Dr. Alban also touched upon ethical issues. And he discussed about finer aspects and what is PICOT, which stands for population, intervention, control, outcome, and target. And very important points were discussed. I am extremely grateful to Dr. Alban for this. And on behalf of ANBAI, that is the Association of National Board Accredited Institutions, and on behalf of Narayana Health, I would like to thank Alban and also thank Dr. Srinath for arranging this excellent talk by Alban. And I have requested Alban to come back to us with the topic, how to write thesis, which was not covered today. That is also very important. And I request all the participants to join to gain from the wisdom and knowledge from Alban Sikamani, who is extensively experienced in this subject. I would like to thank the ANBAI for this opportunity, and till we see you again, goodbye and thank you. Thank you very much.
One thing, sir.
Yes, yes. Tell me, Srina.
Sir, Dr. Alban, can we fix it on 20th of this October?
October 20th, yeah. No problem.
Okay.
So, yeah. Please join us back on 20th for this continuation of the same topic, but we'll be discussing more about thesis in the next session. Every Tuesday, 3:30 to 4:30, we have the ANBAI mediated, ANBAI arranged basic science session. Please do not miss it, because it's an important component of the DNB training. Once again, thanking you, I would like to close the session now that we have crossed 4:30, the time allotted to us, and see you sometime.
Bye.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Alban.
Thank you. Bye-bye.